Again, my name is Rychiee Espinosa, and this is Seth McDowell, and together with, we're McDowell Espinosa. We were officially founded in 2010 after several collaborations at Columbia University's GSAP. And together, our partnership produces a hybrid identity that is stimulated by the tensions between East and West, North, South, male, female, biological, artistic, technical, conceptual, clean, and dirty.
For the last 3 years, we've been working as complementary opposing forces from two drastically different locations. Rychiee works from a brownstone in Brooklyn, and I am working from a storefront in a small town called Scottsville, Virginia. The spatial and cultural juxtaposition is highlighted in the two announcements of our Architectural League Prize. One from Scottsville Weekly, and one from the Architectural League. Where in the Scottsville Weekly, we're sandwiched between Lovin' Oven and the Catfish Catch of the Week. But this positioning allows us to establish a relationship between fantasy and reality, as seen here in a couple photos from our Scottsville office. And this juxtaposition drives the work to continuously negotiate between the tactile physical world and the imaginary speculative world. So our submission for the 2015 Architectural League Prize, exploring the topic of authenticity, focused on our interest in the unfindable. There's no Google entry for the unfindable architecture. An unfindable architecture is the exception, it's the special occurrence, it's the outlier. And with the term unfindable, we're referencing the Catalogue of Unfindable Objects by Jacques, Carelman, published in 1969. This publication was a fantastic invention, was a parody of the mail order catalog, and presented a series of objects that question utility and offer impossible solutions to seemingly irrelevant problems. Carelman's catalog has been translated to a few different words, ranging from fantastic to impossible to unfindable. We prefer the term unfindable and find it provocative in this reference of authenticity, whereby it suggests that a series of products are so unusual and so absurd that they were never manufactured for a mass market. Thus, the design narrative is so unconventional it thwarts the realization of the object, rendering it unfindable or inaccessible to an audience.
Our installation, which you will see after the lecture, presents three design strategies for producing unfindable constructs. This is the resultant of an exercise testing the rules of authenticity. Using an identical set of ingredients, each of us has constructed a series of individual spatial interpretations. These interpretations can be perceived as an exquisite corpse in search of an unfindable antinomy through the manipulation of wax, chewing gum, and wood, each with its individual technique of construction. These constructs are 12-inch cubes that express the nature of tectonics and properties inherent to the material. The spatial qualities are conveyed via drawings and photographs, exploring light and space, scale and structure.
So the first construct is the anomalous construct. An anomaly is produced through the multiplicity of parts. The anomalous is a principle of variance. Nothing, it seems, is so fascinating as the thing that does not fit. The anomaly is, after all, like a stranger estranged. The anomaly is a principle of excess, whereby obscurities disobey the rule that divides identity from alterity. The anomalous is a surprise, a mutation, a simple apparition without tragedy. So what does the anomaly mean for architecture? The immediate instinct is to relate the anomaly to the contextual strategy, but this just leads to tired discussions about architectural formalism and iconic aliens dropped into foreign environments. The anomaly is much more interesting for architecture when it is approached with the methodical agenda to disobey multiple formats. We investigate the anomaly through manipulating the individual unit. Parts, pieces, fragments are arranged and curated to generate something unexpected. The goal is to produce variation within the sameness. To produce the unfindable from excess.
So in a project examining the idea of the anomalous construct, we asked the question, what if the world ran on water? We wondered how a major change in climate would affect available resources and how technological advancement could respond and produce a radical shift in how we live. The project is entitled Water Fuel, a hydrogen fuel scooter network for Manhattan. Recently, engineers have discovered efficient methods of burning salt water with radio frequencies using electrolysis. So our question was, what if electrolysis could create hydrogen fuel? The design then became inspired by a gadget, the electrolyzer. Our ambition was to transform this gadget into a fuel-producing system that would allow it to reduce New York City taxicabs by 50%. The design was based on a series of parts, a floating mat made of bubbles, and modular clipping parts that accumulate to form scooter parking and fueling stations. We proposed that these floating mats could be distributed along the Manhattan shoreline. A new water fuel network would then encompass Manhattan and grow at intervals. The design was then calibrated to a series of energy production parts, to what became known as a fueling mat, which became a new floating landscape for recreation. It becomes a soft infrastructure by which people can play, lay, and sunbathe. Also heated into winter. And in the summer, it is a new public space. The entire system is made of a series of small parts that would clip together and aggregate into one another. So within the city, public restrooms were proposed to become inhabitable electrolyzers. And again, this project was selected first place in the self-sufficient city competition envisioning the habitat of the future.
The second format that we're working with to investigate the idea of the unfindable is around the idea of the syzygy. A formation is produced by the fusion of two opposing materials. Syzygy is the principle of alliance. The word syzygy normally refers to the celestial alignment of three planets, two of which are at opposite antipodes of their orbit around the third. Syzygy relies upon the alignment of the oppositions in order to produce the unexpectedness or surprise. Syzygy depends upon the union of two opposing fragments. So syzygy, our second declension of the exception, is the syzygy of the chiasm, differing from every other thing in a system that values the norm of difference. It serves the will to confuse. We investigate the idea of syzygy through a formless material interaction between two opposing materials. Hot wax is introduced to cold water, and in this process which they are introduced dictates the formation. Artifacts are generated that are not composed, but rather instigated. We designed the encounter, but not necessarily the resultant. This leads to an idea about challenging fixed conditions. Can architecture morph and change like the temperatures of wax and water?
So this project entitled The City of Blubber was featured in the 2013 Hong Kong Biennale. We began this project with the question, what if a city wears its fat? This quality of blubber is directly tied to the spatiality that emerges. The city emerges as layers, as bulges, as ripples, and as rolls. It swells and swells. It begins to suffocate the old city. But the spatial conditions are something that are both sublime and disgusting. The blubber is a new artificial ground that emerges on top of the city of Hong Kong. It is a city that struggles with waste, producing over 6 million tons of waste each year. It is projected that Hong Kong will run out of landfill space by 2018. In this massive plan to stabilize Hong Kong's waste issue, each block within the city is outfitted with a biorefinery that acts as a garbage disposal for the neighborhood. These biorefineries are located in the center of the urban blocks and are networked to each floor of surrounding buildings. A biorefinery involves an upstream processing step which uses a mixture of fungus to break down waste into simple sugars. The blend then goes into a fermenter, a vat where bacteria convert the sugars into succinic acid. Succinic acid is one of the top molecules in green chemistry and can be used to make everything from laundry detergents to plastics to pharmaceutical agents and surfactants. In Hong Kong, this succinic acid is piped to the top of the city where it emerges as bioplastic blubber out of a supporting framework. And this is the model we built for the Hong Kong Biennale. To give you a sense of scale, this model is 6 feet by 6 feet in plan, 3 feet tall. So as you can see, it's a lot of wax. And here are some photos of the various materials and techniques we use throughout the project.
The third sort of format of investigating the unfindable is the Clinamen and the Clinamen construct. And this is an investigation of a material determinant. The Clinamen is a principle of deviance. Clinamen is a term originating from the atomistic doctrine of Epicurus and refers to the unpredictable swerve of atoms. The swerve initiates a principle of deviance, as seen in Derrida's determinant, where items diverge from what directs them, escaping the events of the system that controls them. These divergences are what motivated Duchamp's recontextualized ready-mades, where objects are altered and repositioned to create meaning that opposes its original intention. The swerve of the Clinamen is a material strategy we often deploy. We investigate methods for transforming waste, excess, and the everyday into new spatial conditions. This involves transforming those items commonly associated with degradation into sublime visceral materiality. This is about repositioning the familiar into an unfamiliar context.
So this leads us to our final question. What if we used human hair as building material? The project is entitled My Hair as a MoMA PS1, a collaboration with Katanatuk under the name of Temp Agency, as a proposal for MoMA PS1's 2013 Young Architects Program. We have hair. We let it grow. If you can't, you miss it. And we let it go. It is you. It is culture. There are 19 trillion hairs on New Yorkers. Over 4,000 hair salons in New York City. Each salon produces up to 4 cubic feet of hair clippings daily, and nearly all of it ends up in a landfill. The material that once signified diversity, character, and collective identity is readily forgotten and discarded. This project aims at diverting hair as a material waste stream and fabricating the cultural and architectural potential imbued with thermal, acoustic, and structural qualities as well as life and growth. Working in collaboration with material scientists, hairstylists, medical doctors, and engineers, we revive and transform waste hair into a dynamic, interactive, and resilient modular canvas. My Hair is at MoMA PS1 is a project about curating this process and manufacturing the power and spatial typologies of this living material. Horizontal and vertical variations of the hair rollers offer 6 distinct stage-like environments in the MoMA PS1 courtyards. We call them cut, tease, brush, part, wash, and love cave, and provide a variety of shade, seating, water, as well as intense yet flexible spaces for Expo 1, warm-up, and a barbershop for the ultimate cool-down. With the color-coded tagging system, each hair roller is a further representation of individual salon or barbershop from one of 5 New York City boroughs, and act together as a map of hair taxonomy for the city. The tags guide visitors' quests to find their own hair in salons or barbershops in the MOPS 1 courtyards. So here's a detailed drawing of the vertical component we call a hair roller. We worked with engineers at Bureau Havel to determine the adequate structure, which would be a very thick steel highway plate that would resist wind loads and lateral loads. And also looking at the horizontal components, which we proposed threading through the existing tie holes in the concrete wall that surrounds the PS1 courtyard. And of course, we needed to do a full-scale mock-up to test if this actually works. And it did, according to our test. And we wanted to actually get a model that you could take photos in, get your head inside, complete with fog machine, theatrical lighting, and again, to take a look inside. So I'll show you the video that we presented. So Temp Agency partners with over 120 New York City hair salons and barbershops and collects a total amount of 80 cubic feet of hair for a period of 5 days. Collected hair is carefully inspected, sanitized, dyed, and bound with customized weatherproof fire-retardant silicone, and is affixed to light and rigid metal mesh, then finally to fiberglass poles. My hair is a MOPS1 is a landscape of serendipity layered with scientific and tactile exploration of material and information, and ultimately an architectural expression of renewed life.
Thank you.